She's grown. She's. Right? We speak like that ordinarily. The body is dead. But still we say, we're gone. So who's gone? What's gone? I first experienced this when I was 14 years old in Trinidad. My father died. And of course, at 14, how much can you understand? How much do you know? But at the time, there was a funeral in the church, Catholic church. I was raised like that. My father was not religious. And the only time he didn't die, he would never go inside the church. Really. But at that time, I remember clearly sitting in one of the pews, the benches, and his body was in nearby. In the aisle, and the priest was saying, he called my father by his name, his first name. James is no longer with us. James has departed. James has left the building. So, but I wondered, as hearing him speak like that, I said, well, if he's gone and he's departed, then who is that? What is that in the box, in the coffin? I could vaguely understand that there's a difference between James and his body. But no one explained anything to me. And I don't think anyone around understood. But still, we accepted that he's gone, and from there, then you go to the cemetery. But it wasn't until I was 21 that I came in touch with Eastern philosophy and spiritualism. Then I understood the nature of consciousness, the nature of the soul. And then things became clear. So this chanting is, it's a good thing. So. We're going to chant now. Hare Krishna, Hare Krishna, Krishna Krishna, Hare Hare, Hare Rama, Hare Rama, Rama Hare
Krishna, 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 Krishna. We have a very special guest who's come all the way from Russia today. I was asked to say just two words, which is quite surprising, so I'll try to be pretty too. Bhaktivedanta Goswami has been practicing Bhakti Yoga and chanting this particular mantra that Adindev Prabhu was just leading you into for more than 35 years, which means it's immense, profound meditation and yoga experience. And last time he was here, I think a year back, maybe a little less than that, and then he spoke on the nature of the sound from the scientific perspective, because that's his background. He was a scientist, he is a scientist, and as it goes in Russia, where the whole society was quite godless, and that's something that was preached and people were educated and brought up as, he somehow found a new meaning in life through this mantra, through the sound. And today we asked him to go a little deeper and speak not just about mantra itself, but also about something that we're all genuinely looking for, which is, this word consists of four letters.
Love.
Love and happiness. So about to begin this time, we'll speak about love, and yet we're hoping that it will help us to somehow connect it with the process of chanting that we're all engaged in. So once again,
Sittum Sanjeevaya Dekila Shakti Dharaksana Vinaya Shahasta Charana Shravanatha Gavanta Namunaya Dharaksana Vinaya Shakti Charana. Hare Krishna. I'm very happy to see everyone of you. And I will say a few words about this event, about this method of expressing our love. As we all know, we're all looking for love. That's the deepest desire of every human being. In fact, the very word yoga means connection. And connection is something which we all hankering for. All this modern so-called development is all about connecting people. iPhones, internet, social network. It's all some sort of yoga. Because love is about connection. Love is about yoga. The problem is that in the material world, when people are trying to connect with each other, it's always somewhat distorted, somewhat contaminated by our selfish nature. The selfishness which manifests as expectations, conditions. When we enter into relationship or into connection, we always have some conditions. And ultimately these conditions, they destroy the connection. We want connection. We want to be connected. We want to feel love and to exchange love. But this selfish nature of ours is a very big impediment. And sometimes we don't even know how it destroys the relationship. Those people who in the beginning would say to each other, I cannot live without you. A few months later, will say, I don't want to see your face. Only because of this expectations. It's very interesting in the beginning when mother has a baby. Her love is very pure because naturally she doesn't expect anything from the baby. She just wants to give. And therefore she feels the greatest joy. She always thinks about the baby, you know, her she's so closely connected with the Deity. But then the seed of expectation is still there. It may, from the surface, look very pure, but because the seed of expectation, seed of selfishness is still there, and this seed grows along with the baby. And the baby grows, the seed grows, and love disappears. In the beginning it was so pure, she just wanted to do something for the baby, to give something. But then a few years later, you know, sometimes children and parents, they hate each other. Again, the same dynamic is there. Because of this selfishness or selfish nature of human being, ultimately our connections are being destroyed mercilessly, even though we don't want it, and we don't know what to do with this. So this bhakti yoga is actually the greatest way to establish the connection with God, and ultimately brings us closer to God. I wanted to, because this happens with human beings? Why this connection of love always always ultimately corrupted by our expectations? Because we are conditioned. Our love is conditioned because we are conditioned. Our karma, our previous samskaras, they all create desires, they all create expectations. And if two people are conditioned, their relationship cannot be unconditional. But God is so great that He gave us little experience, little glimpse of what it means to have unconditional relationship. Everyone has this, some experience of it in his life. When we see somebody and when we experience something which we call love, ultimately, it's not that we love this person. We love the divine nature of this person. For some time, God gives us this experience that we see God in him. Ultimately, we are looking for God. And he's just kind of hinting, you're looking for me, but you're looking in the wrong place. You know, we look on a boy or on a girl, and we think, you know, and we have this experience of love for, you know, sometimes even for a few weeks, if we're lucky. And we're totally oblivious of everyone, of everything else, and we're completely happy in this experience. But then, sooner or later, the illusion disappears and we see the ugly face of somebody who is not so divine. But actually the real experience is that we see the divine spark in this person. The spark of divine qualities, and the spark of divine qualities inspires us so much. And that inspiration is so great that people are always looking for it, again and again and again. Therefore, in Vedic tradition, in Vedic culture, in Vedic religion or whatever, in Vedic civilization, the name of God is Krishna. When we're singing this song, we're basically looking or attracting, trying to get the experience of somebody who is attracting everyone. Krishna means all attractive. Krishna means somebody who has all the attractive qualities. And whatever attraction we feel, whatever experience of attraction we have in this world, it's ultimately for Him. Because He is the center of all attraction. He is this attractive force around whom everything rotates. Like sun has this gravitation force, attraction force. Ultimately, it's coming because it's a part of Krishna, part of God. So that's the nature of God. He's all attractive. He's attracting. He's pulling us to himself. And whatever attraction we feel is ultimately for him. So I want to say a few words about the nature of this experience in the purest form. It is explained in a great treatise about love, which is called Priti Sandarbha, that experience of love consists of three things. Whatever experience of love we have, it always has these three components, which we have to be very clear about. And the greatest joy, the greatest happiness which we experience is because of these three things. The first thing in love is that when we feel this initial attraction, when we see somebody who is attracting us and we feel this initial sort of favorable attitude, this is the first thing we want, that this person will become happy. This initial feeling, let everything will be okay with him. Let he become happy, let he become very joyful or whatever. So this favorable attitude is the beginning of love. As much as when we hate somebody, then the feeling towards this person is, let something wrong will happen with him. And you feel very happy if something wrong happens to you. You feel, yeah, that's right. That's right. So, but in the same way, you know, initial desire or attitude, let everything will be all right with him, let him be happy. And this in itself gives joy to you. So that's the first thing, the first manifestation of love. Your attitude, your favorable attitude. Then the next thing, which is very important for the development of love, if you really want to experience this love, then the next step is, again, very important. If you want that this person should be happy, then you should definitely inquire or desire to know what makes this person happy. Sometimes when we love somebody, you know, and we want to enter into a relationship, and we really have this nice attitude, and we try to do something for this person. But then the person, he's displeased with what we're doing. And we're trying to do, and we say, you know, I want to do something good for you, and he says, go to hell with all this your endeavors. Because we didn't bother to inquire what he really likes, what he needs. Because the nature of love ultimately is about serving. And service means I do something what the other person needs, what he wants. It's not that what I do what I want to do and let him take it. No. I have to know, I have to find out what pleases him. And that's the second aspect of love. And the third aspect of love, the second aspect of love is the dynamic, active will to make him happy. And the third aspect of love is the experience when I'm sure that I did something for him. I have this favorable attitude, and because of this favorable attitude, I did something which is pleasing to him. And when I know that he is pleased, I am pleased myself. And the joy which I feel is actually greater than the joy which he feels. Because of this love, because of this magic of love. This magic of love actually makes me more happy when he is happy than his experience of happiness. My experience is greater. Mother enjoys more when she sees how her little son eats something which she cooked. More than the son. Son is eating and it's kind of nice. But she enjoys more, and her happiness is more pure. So these three things is the manifestation of pure love. And whenever we have these things towards other people, we are happy. And this is the source of happiness for ourselves. But unfortunately, very soon, this experience is destroyed by our nature. Our nature says that, you know, yeah, he's happy. What about me? How about me? Can I be just happy because he's happy? No, no, this is too dangerous. But this is the safest position. Because when we are just serving and doing something for somebody else with the pure heart, we are very happy, and this is the safest situation in the world. And basically, Bhakti Yoga teaches us how to make God happy. He is the purest, unconditional living being. And he is ready to give love. And ultimately, it's very important also to know, if we have this feeling of love, then it's practically 100% guaranteed that if our feeling is pure, then the other person will feel the reciprocal feeling towards us. If we do something in a very pure way, sometimes people, they just say, you know, what if I do it and he still don't like me? First of all, it's okay. Because you will be happy anyway. But second of all, love is very powerful. This unconditional love, if you do this, if you serve, and you serve unconditionally, then it's for sure that the other person will feel some reciprocation with you. And for sure, if we express certain favorable attitude towards God, he definitely will feel some reciprocation with us. He wants to give love. He's actually looking for the moment when we express our love and attitudes towards him. And this chanting is the highest expression of love, not for us. Ultimately, all these mantras, they are ways to communicate with God. In Sanskrit, there is word Rishi. And Rishi means sage. Rishi means somebody who is a very wise person, who is... But literally, Rishi means seer. Why he is called seer? Because he has seen mantra. All these mantras which are chanted in kirtans, they are not just words. They are way of communicating with God, revealed in the trance of this great rishis. And when we repeat mantras, we're more or less trying to reproduce their experience. Their experience was that in their communion with God, through the purity of their heart, they would see the sound manifestation of God. And when they repeat the same sound, especially when we get the sound from a pure heart, from the mouth of a very pure person, who is doing it very selflessly, then the same experience which they had can come to us. To a certain extent, at least a shadow of the same experience can come to us. And that's the method of kirtan. We're chanting something which they would chant in complete oblivion of love. But when we repeat it, we have the glimpse of their experience. And ultimately, it's also very important to understand that it's not that we chant mantra. In the higher sense, and in the purest sense, we are being chanted by mantra. And it's not just a nice sort of way of expressing something. In reality, it is like this. And there is plenty of experiences of people who chant mantra that ultimately mantra comes from the higher plane and it's just using you as an instrument. I have little experience which I wanted to share with you, which is very interesting. I started practicing this Krishna consciousness and chanting mantra in 1980, 36 years back. And at that time I was in Russia, and Russia was Soviet Union, and Soviet Union was completely closed, and there was no question of doing something religious in this country. Anything which had any religious connotation was strictly banned from the country. And as soon as you would do something which had something to do with any sort of religion, with any conception of God, you would be totally ostracized from the society and oftentimes put in prison. So I was doing my, innocently, I started chanting, you know, because somebody told me, and you know, very soon I became a center of attraction for KGB. Of course, they didn't know that they were attracted by Hare Krishna mantra. Krishna is all attractive. They thought that they're trying to... But anyway, so it was sort of love, but distorted by material conditions. So, and oftentimes, Hare Krishna, Hare Krishna, Krishna Krishna, Hare Hare, Hare Rama, Hare Rama, Rama Rama, Hare Hare. It was in some tune, you know, I would hear this music inside me. And this would give me such a joy, immense joy. It was not some sort of, you know, it was not that I would just imagine something, because in this situation, you could only imagine how you would be rotten in Siberia and put in prison. So all of a sudden, this very real spiritual experience would descend upon me, and in this moment, I would become very happy, and I would become very, you know, self-confident, and I would look at him, and all of a sudden, he would become very small. And he stopped smiling, and I would smile at him. The situation would change 180 degrees. He would be just trembling there all of a sudden, and I would say, so what do you want? Just ask me? And just ask, no problem. And ultimately I would say, okay, I'll go. And I would go. All from him, and that would repeat probably few times. I don't remember how many times, but repeatedly the same experience was there. That the sound of mantra would come upon you, and when we chant, the same thing happened. You know, with Krishna, when we chant his holy name, he kind of pretends that we're doing. But ultimately, he is giving us this opportunity to chant his name. It's something like this. If you have a small child, and you are a father, the father of this child, and this small little child is trying to lift a weight, you know, and he's, you know, sometimes children, they are very, you know, they have this ego, you know, I don't do it. And obviously they cannot do it. And you're coming from behind and you're just, you know, lifting this weight. And the little child is, you know, oh, see, I lifted it. But you're there and you're smiling. Yes, yes, you're my child, you're very nice. So exactly the same thing happens when you chant this song. Please don't think that you are chanting. If you try to just let the sound go through you, go through your mind, and you know, let the sound descend upon you, and you just float in the sound, then the real experience will come upon you. You just try to express within your heart whatever little love you have, or whatever desire for love you have. We may not have love, but we all have hankering for love. The love may not be there, may or may not be there, but the hankering, the understanding that we need love is there. And if when we chant, this desire is there, this hankering is there, let me experience love, let me do something. Because I know that you want me to do it. Then this amazing experience will come upon you, and you will feel that mantra is going through you, and you are vibrating in harmony with the whole universe. Because ultimately, this sound is not just ordinary sound. It's the sound, the vibration, which upholds the whole universe. And it may sound a little, you know, bombastic or whatever, a little, little exaggerated. But in reality, we cannot even express what is happening in reality when we chant this holy name. It's really something very significant. And what requires from us is only one thing, is that we concentrate our heart upon this desire. I want to do something. Oh my Lord, this is how the founder of our movement, he translated this mantra. He says that this mantra is the highest expression of love, because love ultimately means service. When we love somebody, as I explained, we want to do something for the person whom we love. And this mantra is this expression of our desire to serve. Because ultimately, we all want to serve. Because we all want to love. And when this attitude will be there in our heart, when we chant, then the experience of kirtan will be the greatest. Will be the most profound, and this experience will always be with you, especially in the most dangerous and in the most critical moments of your life. As I explained, in my case, my little, very feeble, very insignificant endeavors to do something, they manifested in this amazing feeling of protection and shelter, which I felt in a very awkward and a very dangerous situation. It just came upon me that I'm completely safe. I'm under the divine protection. Because this sound is there, and our little endeavor to serve this sound with a pure heart will give immense benefit to us. And ultimately will teach us what the pure love is, because when we chant this sound, we come closer to God, and God is love personified. And when we are connected with Him through this sound, this experience of His love is coming to us. We feel His love, His experience. And this is the greatest thing which can be there. So I'm very happy that we are all doing this, because this is the best thing which we can do in our life, and this is what our life is all about. So, thank you very much.
Thank you very much.
So, after that nice, wonderful explanation by Maharaj, I think it's only proper for us to chant some mantra. I could say something about this chanting. It's not from this world. It's a foreign import. Yeah. we are told by one of the spiritual teachers in our line, Golokera Premadan Harinam Sankirtan. So, Golokera, that is the planet in the spiritual world, the highest planet, where Krishna resides. And Premadan is the wealth of that place is love, prema. There's two words in Sanskrit. Prema means love, kama means lust. So Premadan, the real wealth of the spiritual world, is descended in this chanting, this kirtan. Kirtan. So, there may be many different kinds of kirtan. Kirtan means to glorify. Glorify the virtues of another. But we are recommended that to kirtan of the names, the holy names of God. And this Krishna kirtan, the type of kirtan mainly, has been given by none other than Krishna himself, Krishna Chaitanya. And he informed us that when we engage in this kirtan, glorification of Krishna, that what we will experience is our heart will become purified, our mind will become purified. Our whole existence will become purified. Then we can really experience love. As Maharaj said, everybody wants love. Well, actually, we exist for love. We live for love. Seems to escape us. So, but we are meant for love, no doubt. A man or a woman will risk everything for love. Yes. And without love, we may possess everything and still we feel something is missing. That's why sometimes you hear so many expressions of love. The songwriters write about love, the poets write about love. You hear people say that this other person, she makes me feel whole. He makes me whole. So, we live for love. And we will not rest until we find it. So, we've tried so many things. Why not try this chanting and see, experience. When we have a genuine experience, then we can proceed, we can go on. without experience, you live in it. But this chanting will give us that experience that we are looking for. Hare Krishna, Hare Krishna, Krishna Krishna, Hare Hare, Hare Namo, Hare Namo, Hare Krishna, Hare Krishna, Krishna Krishna, Hare Hare.